Hi, this is Dr. Tiffany So, radiologist, and today I'm going to go through the interpretation process for a very commonly requested study, a CT pulmonary angiogram, which is otherwise known as a CTPA. A CTPA is a study of choice at most institutions for evaluation of patients with acute pulmonary embolism, and this is particularly in patients with a high clinical pretest probability of pulmonary embolism.
Here we have axial images from a CT pulmonary angiogram with a 0.625 mm slice thickness. Before we start interpretation, begin by assessing the overall exam quality. We can assess the adequacy of pulmonary arterial enhancement by looking at the contrast within the pulmonary arteries. Ideally, we're looking for high density contrast within the pulmonary arteries. If your viewer has capacity for attenuation measurements, we can draw a region of interest at the main pulmonary artery. Make sure the circle covers at least 50% of the diameter of the vessel. Generally, we're looking for a level of at least 210 Hounsfield units in the main pulmonary artery. Make a note of other factors which may make the study suboptimal for diagnosis. Respiratory or cardiac motion artifact can cause vessels to be less sharp or blurring of vessels. This is not uncommon as patients cannot hold their breath well and tachycardia can be common. It is probably easiest to confirm this on long windows. Excessive image noise is usually related to patient body habitus. And streak artifacts can sometimes be seen from high density contrast in the SVC or central venous catheters, which can obscure adjacent pulmonary arteries. The next step is changing the window setting, as if the contrast is too bright within the vessel, smaller or low density pulmonary emboli can be obscured. Some advocate that a pulmonary emboli specific window setting can be used. Or we can just manually adjust the window so that the contrast is not so bright and we can see through the contrast. Right click and drag the mouse to change the window. And now we can start to review the case. To recap the anatomy, this is the level of the main pulmonary artery, and here we have the main pulmonary artery, the right and the left pulmonary arteries, the ascending and the descending aorta, the SVC, the right and the left main bronchus, and the esophagus. Review the pulmonary arteries systematically, starting from centrally, the main pulmonary artery. Scroll up and down and look at all slices which cover the main pulmonary artery. Look for any filling defects to suggest PE. Then move to the right and repeat for the right main pulmonary artery, and then the left main pulmonary artery. By doing this, you can quickly exclude a major PE or a saddle PE. Then moving back to the right, follow each lobar, segmental and subsegmental branch out separately. The pulmonary arteries follow the same branching pattern as the bronchopulmonary segments. We look at the first branch, which comes off the right pulmonary artery, which is the truncus anterior, and this supplies the right upper lobe. Here we have its apical, anterior, and posterior segmental branches, and we follow each of these as far out as we can. The interlobar pulmonary artery, which supplies the right middle and the right lower lobes, then runs inferiorly. Here we look at the right middle lobe pulmonary artery, which rises from the anteromedial aspect of the right interlobar artery. Here are its medial and lateral segmental branches. Again, follow each of these out as far as we can to look for any abnormal filling defects to suggest PE. After giving off the right middle lobe pulmonary artery, the right interlobar artery then provides the right lower lobe artery. We look at the first branch coming off, which is the superior segmental branch. Here it is coming off posteriorly. We then look at the common basal trunk, which provides the medial basal, the anterior basal, and the posterior basal and lateral basal segments. We follow each of these out separately. Now moving back up to repeat the same for the left side, we follow the branches to the left upper lobe. Here we have the anterior, apical, and posterior segmental branches to the left upper lobe. We follow each of these out separately. Then we look at the lingular segmental branch, which comprises of the superior and inferior branches. the superior and inferior lingular branches can be better appreciated on coronal images. We then follow the apical segmental branch, which supplies the apical segment of the left lower lobe. And lastly, looking at the basal trunk, which terminates in its branches to the anterior medial, posterior, and lateral basal segments.